Yes, isn't it? So when you love somebody, when you love God, you want to know more about a person that you love. Is it not natural? So therefore, how can the love and God be different? It is natural. So therefore, and also when you love somebody, the entire existence of a person is also loved. Everything about the person is loved. Isn't it? Just like, sometimes what happens, if you don't have a good relationship with somebody, you hate somebody. Okay? You hate somebody. You are looking every opportunity to damage this person. Though it may be in the form of damaging his car. Isn't it? You just hate somebody. Okay, so this is may not be a good example for us to give. But when we were back in Gurukul, we used to go for the Go Seva. So the part of like once a week we used to go is we would like go to the place where the cows were kept. So there were about 400 cows. So every two cows are assigned to one of us. So that day what we had to do is we had to carry a thaili of atta, you know, the dough. So we had to carry a dough and we had to carry a gourd. We were given a budget. So this is how much you can spend in your cow today. So like that we would go for a go-seva, service of the cows. So they would give us a budget. So now if you want to feed your cow more, then you have to go for madhukari. You know what madhukari means? You have to go and beg from people. I mean, in India, that is very common. So what we would do is, we would actually, you know, and I was always a good collector, even in Gurukul. So I would come out of Gurukul and I would go for begging to the village first. So what we would do is that we used to go to the door-to-door of the people. First, we used to just go where the cows are kept, and I used to throw the cow dung away. You know, this cow dung. So I used to first go and throw the cow dung from their place. So later on, they say, beta, kya chahiye? Of course, they would say, dudh chahiye. So dudh we had enough. So we had thoda atta to. So we used to beg for more atta, the dough. So they would give some, you know, few clays of dough. Then we would go to somebody's garden where there are a lot of flowers. So we would actually, you know, go and help them to, you know, water the garden sometime. Or sometime take the twigs off the garden. So later on they say, beta, kya chahiye, phool chahiye. So we were making a garlands also there. So that way, like we are looking into every reason of why my cow should look better than them. It was a competition. It's a mood of competition. So sometime what would happen was, as we were burying the cow, just to make sure that somebody else's cow is not better, we used to take some dirt and put in somebody's bag, you know, because that was not my cow. But that was a childish, but as at the same time playful. The cows never mind, because they knew what category we were in at that point. So just to make my cow look better, because it's not that I did not like the cow, but just that boy is so creative. He's doing too good things, too many good things. So in one way, because I can't do anything to him, I end up putting some dust into the cow. So the enmity that we have for somebody is such that sometime, even if you can't damage him, we'll damage his property. He's not looking today, his car, or, you know, take my key and just scratch around, you know. Which, you know, sometimes people have a sign of hatredness all over the place. This is very common. So this compassion has to come in every form. As soon as it becomes, I like this, I don't like this, this is not a compassion. You cannot be choosy about compassion. If it is a real love, the Shastra says, either it is love or it is lust. Just because you love somebody, because you can get somebody off them, that is not love, is it? What is that? It is called the lust. Because you are trying to get something of somebody. So therefore you intend to love a person. Does anybody love a thing or a person that does not give them anything? Very less. Maybe a great preacher, like Jesus Christ himself, even helping the people who never do anything to him. Or Srila Prabhupada, when he came to this country, he did not know who would be helpful and who would not be helpful. Only the great personalities. Otherwise, the Shastra said, loving my daughter, loving my wife, it is not the real love. Because you are getting something off the home. But real love with Krishna, especially when you get don't get anything from him. Every time you get disappointed. Like we were doing a Sikshastika prayer last week. So the last verse of the Sikshastika is what? One of the verses is called Asmi Seva Padaratam Pinastumam Adarshanam Maramahatam Karutuva Yatha Tatha Bhavidhatu Lampatu Matprana Natas to Saivana Paraha. What does that mean? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying, the technology is so great, it's already popping out. Huh? So, okay, Asli Seva Padaratam. I know no one but Krishna is my Lord. Okay? So, this is the first fixed part. My mind has totally accepted Krishna, but not with any condition. What is the condition that he has accepted Krishna in? Prabhu, you want to read? It's behind me.
And he shall remain so, even if he handles me roughly by his embrace, or makes me broken-hearted by not being present before me. He is completely free to do anything and everything, for he is always my worshipful Lord unconditionally.
So, Krishna is not my lovable object just because whenever I go to him, to the temple, I fold my hands, Krishna immediately gives me what I want. So therefore I love him. That's not a true love. What is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying, sometime being satisfied with me, he might just grab me and embrace me. That is possible. But sometime he might never appear before me and make me brokenhearted. But I'm not going to change my position of loving Krishna. I will always love him. So this is the real form of love. Unconditional, that's what it is called. Anything that is conditional is called the lust. Because there is some object that you want to get off the person. So in order to derive that, you have to show some type of a reciprocation. So that happens a lot in family life. Isn't it? It's natural. Sometimes if the wife always cooks what you want, there is a chance that their family life is most lovable. Because every day the husband gets what he wants. Say that if you say, you know, rice, she cooks you upma. Or you say upma, she keeps you dai bhat. Then there is going to be some fishy relationship. Because you are not getting what you want from them. So in this material world, the true love can only be there with Krishna and his devotees. Or the sample of such a love are between two relationships, the Shastras say. Not husband and wife. It's just the mother and the child. In most of the cases, the father will only play with the child if he is completely clean. Say that if he poops in the diaper and whole diaper is dirty, then you know, the child says, Papa, Papa, that is first mama. First get cleaned up by mama, then next part is papa. So because of this unconditional love between a mother and a child, the Shastras say, yes, the sample of love can be found within the relationship of a mother and a child, not a father and a child. Fathers are a little bit picky here. Am I right or wrong? Sorry?
Correct,
yes. So this type of relationship. So with Krishna, this relationship is there. So all the Maharaj Raugan is loving Krishna very much. Isn't it? Because he is going for Sadhu Sangha every day. But what is his problem? What is his problem right now?
Compassionate.
He is not compassionate to the living entities. How is it possible? Just like Prabhupada used to give an example. You know, says, Papa, I love you so much. Five brothers. All five brothers love the father. But they cannot cooperate with each other. Never. So one day the son went. The older son went and says, you know, our youngest brother is so stupid. He has no brain. He doesn't think. So can four of us just, you know, cut him up, chop him up and just fry him and eat him? Is that okay? So what is Krishna going to say? Or what is father going to say? Yes, no problem, because he has no brain, you know. He is of a lower category, it is okay for him to you to eat him. Is it? So it is possible, within the same family, not everyone is same. Even five brothers, not everyone same. My mother used to say, five fingers, not everything is equal here. One is big, one is small, one is fat. There is so many things going on here. But just because this is, you know, taller than this one, now this one breaks this one down. What type of society is that? Isn't it? Just like to create a strong fist, what does it require? The combination of five fingers together. Say my pinky goes out and I create a thumb or fist with that. Does it work out? So in order to have a perfect society, there is a requirement of compassion to the whole society itself. The whole society is made of compassion. Therefore, in every religion, there is a concept of compassion. Daya is one of the compassion. And one of the third commandment is what? Thou shalt not kill. Same thing, the compassion comes out. And one of the commandments is, you shall treat your neighbor as you treat yourself. So therefore, treat another living entity as you expect somebody to treat you. So the mercy is not only into human, it's not that another neighbor, but another living entity. Maharaj Raghuvan was missing that part out. Unknowingly though, he never thought to that level, even the ant in the ground is equal to me. He never got to that level. He said, no, you need to get this straight out, my dear king, before you get Krishna, because you are not going to get Krishna otherwise. Compassion starts from right there. So therefore, Maharaj Raghuvan, he's been taught by Maharaj Jadvarat. So now, after this, Maharaj Jadvarat is going to ask, Raghuvan is going to ask a simple question. This world is so hard, so difficult. The living entities are suffering always. Everyone knows that they are suffering, but no one wants to come out of the suffering. Isn't it? Everyone knows that they are seeing the bad dream, but no one wants to wake up. Why is that? So this question is put forward. So in order to give this answer, the next chapter that we will be discussing from is going to be a chapter called The Forest of a Material Entanglement. And this is going to be again by Jadvarat. So you would say this entire material world is like a forest, he is going to give an example of. And he is going to explain how every living entity has been entangled into this forest. You know how you can be entangled sometime? You try to run from one side of the forest, you can find the end.